Academy for Lifelong Learning. And I'm happy to introduce tonight's speaker, but before I do that, I'd like to thank gnat-tv for being here. They videotape a number of our programs, so thank you. And Noah Coburn is a political anthropologist who specializes in local political structures, violence, and dispute resolution in Afghanistan. He received his doctorate in anthropology from Boston University in 2010, his master's in regional studies from Columbia University, and his BA from Williams College. He has taught at the American University of Afghanistan, Boston University, the University of Michigan, and Skidmore College. He is currently at Bennington College, where he teaches courses on violence, politics in non-Western societies, and research methodologies. Please join me in welcoming Noah Coburn.
Thanks. Thanks for coming out tonight. I should warn you that I got back from Afghanistan yesterday, actually, so I'm a little bit jet-lagged, but I think as long as I get some momentum, I should be fine. But if I start nodding off up here, somebody just start waving your hands. And also, I love coming up to Manchester. This is my first of two appearances in Manchester in the coming weeks. The next will be at the Manchester Half Marathon, which I always like running in, which is a good event, but that will be quite different. As Gloria said, the big thing that I'm interested in is I'm interested in local governance. I'm interested in how communities work and how they don't work. And in particular, I'm interested in the case of Afghanistan, how some of these ways of interacting with the state, when interacting with each other, have changed over the course of the current international intervention. And because I'm an anthropologist, I tend to start on the very micro level. So what I want to do in today's talk is sort of start small and really start at where I really began doing my research, and then we're going to work our way up a little bit. So I want to introduce to you one of my favorite towns. It's called Istalif. It's in the mountains about an hour and a half north of Kabul. It's primarily Tajik. You can see here, it sort of sits in the foothills. This is the springtime, so that snow is going to slowly melt. And if we turn to the next one, fill up the rivers, which then come through the center of town. And they go and get fed into these series of fairly complex irrigation systems. These irrigation systems are actually mentioned by Emperor Babur in his memoirs. So we know they've been there for quite a while. And as a result, the area is quite rich. It's very fertile. There's lots of produce. You can see this is actually the view from my balcony. You can see there's grape arbors here. Over here is an orchard that, of course, is a wintertime shot. But the area is very lush, and especially in a place like Afghanistan, where a lot of people grow wheat, things like fruits, things like pomegranates, which you can see over here, things like mulberries, these are high-value crops. So as a result, land is quite valuable. What happens when land is valuable? Well, then there's more conflict over land than you would see in other places where land isn't as valuable. So one of the things I was looking at in this town was why, and this is when I was doing my initial PhD research. This was essentially from 2006 into 2008. And if you remember, 2006 to 2008 is really when the insurgency started getting off the ground. But the interesting thing was, while there are pockets of insurgency in the three districts around me, my district remained quite stable. So the focus of my dissertation shifted from looking at how the community interacted with each other to looking at why this district was more stable than the ones around it, particularly when you had a large amount of incentive for conflict. And this large incentive for conflict has played out in Istalif's history quite a numerous number of times. This is a picture taken of the Central Bazaar by a journalist friend of mine in 2002, but these are pictures that I took more recently. The entire town was leveled by the Taliban in 1997. They essentially went through and blew up the main buildings, burned the roofs off the rest, and forced everyone out of town. But when you start asking the Istalifis about it, They'll say, well, when the Taliban forced us out of town, they gave us 24 hours to leave and pack our belongings. When the British destroyed our town in 1842, they didn't give us 24 hours to leave. So the Taliban aren't as bad as the British. So the town was destroyed by the British in 1842. It was destroyed by a series of Pashtun tribes in 1927 as a sort of gift from the king. He allowed a series of Pashtun tribes to sort of ride through the Tajik areas up here. The king, of course, was Pashtun during that period. It was destroyed again about 5 years later, and then destroyed in 1997. So here you have a town which has been absolutely leveled four times in the last 170 years or so. But why has this happened? Well, one of the reasons I gave you was the area is quite disputed by a large number of groups. It's primarily Tajik, but there's Pashtun and Hazara pockets around it. And if we look on a map, this isn't the greatest map, but the town is right here. This is one of the main rivers that feeds into the Kabul River down here. Just to orient yourself, this flat area here is the Shamali Plain. The Shamali Plain, and then Kabul's right there. And the Shamali Plain is quite well known because it's quite fertile, it's quite lush, and it's where Bagram Air Base is. So the main international air base in the country, sort of right smack in the middle here. And when you sit on your rooftop in Istalif, you can look down and sort of watch the planes land, and you can see those invisible drones sort of gliding by every now and then. So here's Istalif, and you can see it's in this little river valley. And up here, just to orient you a little bit more, is the Bamiyan Valley, which is where the Buddhas were destroyed by the Taliban. The Bamiyan Valley also is a great place to muster forces if you want to take Kabul. So throughout history, both the Bamiyan Valley and the Panjshir Valley have been a place for sort of rebel troops to arm themselves and get ready to attack Kabul. And this has happened sort of repeatedly through Afghan history. So if you're the king sitting down in Kabul and you don't want that to happen, the best thing for you to do is to stick a couple troops down at the base of these valleys and sort of cut them out from entering into the Shamali Plain where they can sort of gain steam and then roll into Kabul. So the Soviets did this quite often with the Panjshir Valley. This is where Massoud, the famous freedom fighter, was. And they've done this numerous times with the Bamiyan Valley here. The interesting thing, though, is once the troops are cut off right here, all of a sudden the Istalif River Valley becomes this sort of escape valve. So the interesting thing about Istalif is in times of peace, it's just this beautiful little valley. But in times of war, it all of a sudden becomes this very strategic crossing point. And so as a result, this is one of the real reasons it's been pulled into these national conflicts time and time again. But the interesting thing that I found in 2006 when I was there is that it wasn't getting pulled into the current conflict. And this is quite odd because you've got Shikhar Dariya over here where there's a large amount of insurgency. You saw some of this over here up in Charikar, and then in Kapisa over here you saw quite a good bit of it. So what was going on in Istalif? And this is sort of the question that I looked at. And while I was there looking at this, I was living with a group of potters. So I sort of started at the very lowest level and was looking at how these families interacted. I looked at marriage alliances. I looked at relationships between brothers in particular, relationships between sort of poorer potters and richer potters, to look at how this group was working. And just to take a step back for a second, the hills around Istalif are sort of this decaying granite, which produces a fairly, to be honest, low-quality clay. But clay nonetheless. And Istalifi potters have been working for generations to make this nice sort of blue glaze. You can see there's other colors here that they make. There's a brown over here. This is not glaze. That's earthenware that's just been sort of painted. You got some imports here from Pakistan, which are sort of flooding into the market. But this blue glaze pot has been made there for generations. And the potters have been very good at preserving the art and the science of how to make these pots. So quite often, early in my stay, I would ask some of the potters about, well, how do you make such and such a glaze? And they would say, well, we take a little of this, we take a little of that, and we sort of mix it all together. But then you watch them and you realize, no, they're taking sort of careful measurements, and they're taking exactly this much and exactly that much. And one of the reasons that the potters have been able to thrive for so long is they are literally the only group in Afghanistan who knows how to make glazed pottery. And in a society where most people are illiterate, you don't have the internet, you don't have community workshops to learn how to make pottery, it's possible for these 700 people to basically preserve this tradition and make sure that they have a monopoly on all of the pottery, on all of the glazed pottery made in Afghanistan. And they were very good at sort of preserving this knowledge. And as I stayed there for more and more months and they realized that I wasn't actually going to sort of run away with their secrets, and they're really concerned about you taking the secrets and not sort of bringing them back to America, but bringing them to the village next door. They were very concerned about that. And so they sort of opened up a little bit more as time went by. But preserving this monopoly of knowledge was one of the things that really made them a closely knit group. They didn't let outsiders come into their workshops to work. They would sometimes hire someone down the road to sort of sweep it out or something like that, but they were never involved in the glazing process. Also, I get questions about the role of women in all of this. The women do all the decorations. They don't actually make the pots or fire the pots. And one of the reasons they don't do that is because the women marry out of the family. So if the women knew how to do all this and took information with them, this would be very good. So the other interesting thing about how the pottery is made, flip ahead one, back. Thanks. The other interesting thing that's how pottery is made, in comparison with other groups in town, the potters were a little more unified. And I sort of struggled to understand why this was at first. For example, the weavers were much less unified. They didn't work together as collectively. They didn't marry into each other as often. And one of the things I came to realize is that practice of making a pot and the practice of weaving is very different. If you're a weaver, you can essentially take up a loom, set it up in your house, and go. And then when you have a son, he can do the same thing, or he can buy a new loom and set out on his own. The problem with making pots is that you need to build a kiln. You need to build a kiln, which are quite large in Istalif. They usually fit about 900 to 1200 pots per firing. They're sort of these large updraft kilns. And also, when you're on the wheel here, it's much easier. This is my friend Abdul Wakil. And what you can't really see is he's got some clay that's prepared over here, right? At the time that he's making this, his brother is standing over here preparing the clay for him. In the meantime, his son is probably going to take these pots off and run them out into the courtyard to start drying them. And this is not a recreational activity as it is for us here in the States. And Abdul Wakil can easily make a pot every minute. But he can only do this because he's got sort of a couple brothers that he works with and his sons are in the workshop. So the practice of making the pots actually encourages sons to stay working with their fathers, encourages brothers to stick together in the way that they weren't doing with the weavers, in part because there weren't the same economic incentives for them to all stay together. So, economic incentives to stay together, but at the same time, when they were making pots, but at the same time, they are competing against each other when they're selling the pots. There's about 30 pottery stores in the area. Most workshops own their own pottery stores, and most workshops are usually staffed by the youngest son in the family. The older sons are oftentimes at home making the pots, and you'll hear a little bit more about this man, but this is Mohammed Islam. He is the son of the leader of the pots, of the potters. And this is his store right here. This is Abdul Jafar. He's actually the brother of Abdul Wakil, the guy who was making the pots over here. And he sort of runs the store while his brother is up in the mountains making the pots. Now, the problem is, in the Istalif Bazaar, the Istalif Bazaar has about 200 shops in it. A little less than 30 of those are pottery shops. And these guys are competing against each other to sell the most pots. So all of a sudden, these groups that were working together now have this sort of pressure put on them to compete. Let's go to the next one. And this is happening not just in terms of making pots. In Iskalif, as in much of Afghanistan, to get married, a man has to pay essentially a bride price, but you're also paying for the wedding festival, you're paying for new clothes, you're paying to have this big feast. So to get married, it costs a young man about $10,000. That was sort of the average rate in Iskalif. You could probably pull off a really cheap wedding for $5,000, but less than that was next to impossible. The average sort of laborer salary was about $150 a month. So how do you raise $10,000 to get married? That you don't, right? What you rely upon is your brothers, your cousins, your second cousins, this sort of extended network of people who all of a sudden when you get married, you are in their debt. And then a few years later, your younger cousin gets married, you give him $50 to help him out, then he is in your debt. And so these sort of marriage patterns are constantly reinforcing these same practices that we see in the making of the clay. I talk about some of this stuff. I won't get into all of it, but interesting how this sort of plays out when I discuss this with my students. Afghanistan is Muslim, and Muslim men are allowed to have four wives, but almost nobody in Iskalif had four wives, and almost nobody had two. Everybody had one for the most part, except for a couple of exceptions. But one of the reasons this was is if you're an older man looking to get married, you've got to raise another $10,000, and in the meantime, you already have some sons who are saying, hey, wait a minute, I want to get married too. And so all of a sudden, there's a much more pressure on you not to take in an additional wife, in part because of the cost to your entire network. So the first time you get married, everyone's happy to contribute. But if you try to get married again, everyone's going to say, boo on you. You need to get your younger brother married first or something like that. So this creates a series of family tensions. And the one family I want to talk about first is the Malik. And the Malik is a informal sort of chief head of the potters. And this handsome man here is Malik Abdul Salam. And he is the head of the potters. And the interesting thing about being a Malik is a Malik has certain rights, but also certain obligations. The Malik, when you are harvesting your field, you will take some of your leftover wheat and give it to the Malik. The Malik will collect funds, in particular, to support the mosque. The Malik will then hold these large feasts for the entire community. When an important man dies, the Malik will host the funeral. One of the two major religious holidays in Islam, you have to go and visit the Malik to show your loyalty. But this is not a strictly hereditary position. And this is where it sort of contrasts with roles like the Sheikh that you'll hear about. Everybody knows that Malik Salam has this connection with international forces. And nobody knows what that means, but clearly we should be careful that he has this influence there. And then this is sort of an interesting picture. Anything stand out about this guy here?
No beard.
No beard, right? Every man in Afghanistan has a beard. Not everyone, but a large number of them. That not having a beard is sort of a statement about being a little more Western, perhaps. And so he actually works for one of the local NGOs that runs development projects in the town. And they're quite interesting because on one level, we sort of think about NGOs doing charity and doing development. But when NGOs come in and start running these projects, these are projects that if the NGO wasn't there, the Malik would be running. The Malik, who's sort of in charge of doing things like making sure the irrigation canals are kept open. So in terms of sort of political resources, these elders are then sort of being rivaled by this much younger man. Also, no beard, his skill set, and he speaks English, actually, sort of surprising. Where did he learn English?
Harvard.
Maybe not Harvard, but probably in Pakistan, not in Afghanistan. And if he learned it not in Afghanistan, that means he left. And most of these other guys stayed in Afghanistan when things got really bad with the Taliban. So there's this interesting tension between these sort of young men who speak English, have been abroad, and these older men who don't speak English and stayed the whole time. So there's some interesting tension there. And if we sort of want to diagram this all out, we see there's actually seven groups in town. In columns, I won't get too much into all the terminology, but this is essentially the potters. The potters are right here. You had these international NGOs, international troops, who are another source of power. You've got a rising merchant class who have economic power. You had those religious leaders that I've talked about. You have these former commanders that we call warlords. These guys, for the most part, handed in all of their weapons and when they were disarmed in 2002. But in reality, most of them didn't. They just handed in their sort of old weapons and kept their new ones buried in the backyard. I had a great interview with one of the chief commanders in town where I walked in and he's got one of those pickup trucks in his front yard with an anti-aircraft gun sort of strapped to the back of a pickup, which I think would really damage the pickup if they actually ever tried firing it. But he was talking about, and I was interviewing about the disarmament and demobilization process and what happened when he handed in all of his weapons, and he's describing how all of this happened while he's got like six men surrounding him with Kalashnikovs and ammunition. So there's sort of this thick irony of the commanders being disarmed. But for the most part, in Istalif at least, they're quiet. They have these weapons, but they're not using them. But it's still a source of power. And then the intriguing thing when we think about the government itself, there's a district governor there, and there's also local police. And in Istalif and in several places that I visited, the intriguing thing is the district governor actually has a long-running feud with the chief of police. So the district governor, when you ask him who's in control of things, he says, well, I am. And then you go to the chief of police, and he says, no, I'm in control. And they actually have an office in the same compound, but almost never speak to each other, which creates this really intriguing thing, because the district governor actually has access to government funds. He's got the budget, right? But he can't actually get anything done, because the chief of police is the guy with the police and with all the guns. But he doesn't have any money to actually do anything, which has sort of created this stalemate. And the thing that I'm arguing here is that this structure is one of the things that ironically created stability in Afghanistan, in Istalif. The reason Istalif was stable was because you had all of these different groups that particularly in the mid-2000s were doing okay. People were making some money, Istalif had gotten electricity, schools had been built. So the local police chief, he didn't really like the commander, but better just to sit there quietly and let him have his space and you take your space. Same thing with the district governor. And so they're essentially, for lack of a better term, been a stalemate. And really the only times we saw any sort of real tension is when one of these groups got a little uppity. So if all of a sudden the merchant was starting to make a little bit too much money and people were nervous about him, then you would get the commander, the religious leader, and the potter who would come along and sort of thump him down. And so there was a firm interest in maintaining the status quo, essentially, and making sure that disputes got resolved within the community itself. And the big fear was if anything bubbled up to the national government, either the police would come in, or the American troops would come in, or some outsider would come in, and that would disrupt everything. So there's real interest in sort of preserving this sort of delicate balance. And I'm going a little slower than I wanted to, so I'm going to skip over a couple of things here. But these are sort of examples of how this plays out, and it plays out in some very different settings. This here is a shrine in the center of town where pilgrims will come to pray at the shrine. You can see there's little sticks here. If you have a toothache, you're supposed to stick a stick in the ground, and that's going to make your toothache go away. Similarly, there's a tree that's outside of the picture, and if you're having trouble conceiving, you tie a little ribbon to it. So the tree is just sort of covered in all these ribbons. And then you pray to the keeper of the shrine and give him a little donation down there. So the group that controls shrine ownership makes a lot of money off of it. And so one of the cases that I go much more deeply into in my book was a dispute between the potters and another group called the Syeds over who controlled the shrine. And essentially, all those groups here, if you go back, all these groups here were concerned, well, the conflict was in here, but all these other people were concerned about this sort of spiraling out of control, so everyone came together and sort of supported this resolution of the dispute pretty quickly. And if you go forward, the potters actually lost control of the shrine, but in compensation for this, they were given a large chunk of land and some other things. And so this is sort of how these things play out. And then I won't get too much into this, but this is a micro hydroelectric plant. You can see this is their irrigation canals that run this way. Then all the water goes down there. It was built by the Koreans. And there was a large number of disputes about who was getting electricity, who wasn't getting electricity, whose land had been taken, et cetera, et cetera. But similarly, the sort of community and all these groups came together to resolve those disputes so that it wouldn't get blown out of proportion. So this is what I looked at from 2006 to 2008. And I went back to Afghanistan in 2009. And one of the things I started looking at was how some of these things were shifting in the face of internationally sponsored elections. I was interested in how outside programs, and right, on one level, the election, which is sponsored by the international community, sort of created in this constitution that was very much written by constitutional experts from places like the UN, how these conflicts played out when an election came along. And now during this time, during the previous time I lived primarily in Istilif, during this period from 2006 to 2011, I was based more in Kabul, and so I was studying the election in a whole series of different places. So I'm going to jump around a little bit more, but the big thing I'm interested in is, of those seven groups, what happens to that balance when an election comes along? And one of the things I'm eventually going to argue is thinking about democracy, we can think about it in different ways. We can think about it as institutions, as in elections, as in political parties and things like that, or we can think about it as a value set, liberty, equality, things like that. And those things matter because on one level, everything I've just been discussing has a lot of democratic values to it. All men get the same right to speak in one of these meetings. There's an equality among everybody, whether you're rich or poor. At the same time, if we think about democracy, so democracy as a value set in some ways is actually kind of strong in rural Afghanistan. At the same time, however, and this picture is terrible, but this is the Kunar Provincial Council. This is an elected body that's supposed to be sort of promoting democratization. I went to visit this provincial council center to do some interviews. The thing you can't really tell is, you can see back here, there's sort of a broken down Jeep with a sheep tied up to it. And when I walked in, there was nobody in the entire place but the sheep. So it's really interesting that democracy as an institution in Afghanistan is very weak in a lot of ways. These bodies that have been set up aren't actually performing their duties, but that doesn't mean that the values aren't there. So I just want to keep that in mind as we sort of look at some of the things that happened in Afghanistan in 2009 and 2010. Two elections happened in 2009, presidential election and provincial council. There's 34 provinces, so it's a little bit like your state representative here. And then parliamentary elections the following year, which is like our Senate elections, essentially. And the big reason this all matters is in 2014, these repeat again. And we'll have presidential elections, which are right now scheduled for May of next year, but my guess is that they're going to be delayed till the summer. But 2014, constitutionally, there should be presidential elections. And Hamid Karzai, who's been president essentially since the Americans invaded in 2002, cannot run again. He's limited by two terms in office. So there's a real question about who's going to lead Afghanistan going forward. All that being said, as is true in, I think, small town Vermont, when it comes to politics, all politics are local, right? People are interested in the presidential election, but they actually really know these provincial council candidates. They've got all their, they know their dirty laundry. They know who belongs to what group and who belongs to the other group. So a lot of sort of the gossip, a lot of the push and pull is actually at the parliamentary level. So to jump back four slides, good. If all of a sudden somebody is running for parliament here and becomes a parliamentarian from this group, this is potentially going to throw the entire balance out of whack, right? And this is going to happen on all across Afghanistan. Let's go forward a few more. And why is this? One more. Because essentially elections are open competition for resources. They're an opportunity for different people from different groups to compete in a winner-take-all formula, particularly the type of voting system that they use, which is very similar to the American system. It's called single non-transferable vote. You get one vote in the election, right? This is very different than how most Europeans vote. Most Europeans either use a list system or you get multiple votes. But single non-transferable vote means there's a winner and there's a loser. And sometimes those winner and losers in parliamentary elections were separated by as little as 12 votes. And this winner-take-all attitude is quite different than what I was describing with the Shrine a few minutes ago. In the Shrine conflict, essentially the community came together to give one group certain things, but in compensation the other group received some other things as well. So this type of competition is quite different than you see in other forms of political negotiation in Afghanistan. Furthermore, as these pictures are sort of meant to represent, the elections in Afghanistan were chaotic. They were marred by corruption. Here they're comparing a fake ID to a non-fake ID. Here's a police officer who's just arrested this young man for voting with a fake ID. At one polling station I was friendly with the district governor in that town. And the chief of police came up to me because I was sort of bopping around to different polling stations on election day. And if you're an international going to different polling stations, they just assume that you must be an official. So quite often I was sort of invited behind the scenes because they just thought I must be important if I was there. So he said, you know, I've got all my jail cells filled with people who were voting illegally. And I've started shoving them in the basement of the police station. So what do you think I should do with them? I said, well, this is outside of my remit. But it's really sort of these chaotic moments, in part because the value of getting elected to parliament was so high that people were really willing to compete for these resources. And one of the intriguing things that happened outside of Istalif, but just outside of Istalif, when all of this was going on, was there was a large roadside bomb that went off in 2009 during the provincial council elections. And this is just as I was finishing up my dissertation, which was just talking about how nice and peaceful Istalif was, right? So I'm a little bit nervous when I first hear this. But first of all, I was nervous because there was a bomb, but second of all, I was nervous because this seemed to undermine what I'd been saying, that they'd been able to sort of resolve their disputes in a stable manner. So I went up to start checking things out and to conduct some interviews the next couple of days. And the intriguing thing that started trickling out was, first of all, the roadside bomb went off at 2 o'clock in the morning. Not a good time of day to kill as many people as you can, right? The roadside bomb was also sort of in a ditch next to the road and had really only sort of cracked the pavement. So the intriguing thing, but it was still a big bomb. And so the intriguing thing that sort of came to light were two rumors. Rumor number one was that a candidate who lived down the road was the target of an assassination attempt, and that his car had been driving along, and that they were trying to target him as he went by. And I thought, okay, that's interesting. The more interesting rumor that sort of slowly bubbled up in the days that followed and actually makes more sense is not that the candidate was targeted, but the candidate planted the bomb himself, or one of his friends, planted the bomb and basically had it go off so that the rumor would start that there had been an assassination attempt on him. Why? Because the candidate had realized he was going to lose the election. And losing the election is sort of a loss of honor. If I can't win the election, it shows that I haven't mustered enough votes. I haven't been able to mobilize my community. So am I going to then lose wider support with this very public display of my failure? Well, if that's going to happen, I better remind people that I am a high-value target, and I am a person worth killing. And essentially what this person had responded to is his loss of political capital in the election realm sort of had to be responded to by, compensated for, by showing people that he had the threat of violence to support himself. And all of these pieces we see coming together in some really interesting ways. Another person, so this is a very local candidate. Another person I'll show you a picture of in a little bit who you may have read about in the newspapers is Atta Muhammad Noor, who is the governor of Balkh province, which is one of the most important provinces in the north. He is one of Karzai's really only big rivals in Afghanistan right now. He's very anti-Karzai. There's a rumor going around that Karzai, who has the power to appoint governors, appointed a replacement for him and sent him to replace Atta. And Atta took his rival, in the stories, by the ear, right, and dragged him down to the bazaar and put him in a taxi and sent him back to Karzai. So this is one of the few sort of figures who's been able to stand up to Karzai recently. And he's governing a fairly stable, prosperous district or province in the north. And in the weeks before the election, 2010, the intriguing thing was there was a series of Taliban attacks in the province. And the Taliban don't have much of a presence in the north. So this was very interesting that all of a sudden some Taliban attacks had sort of spiked up in this place where we don't see Taliban sympathizers. Also importantly, Atta is fiercely anti-Taliban. He's Tajik, he fought against them for years, close relatives were tortured and killed by the Taliban. This guy is as anti-Taliban as you can get. And we see this uptick in Taliban attacks. Again, when you start listening to the rumors, what comes out is really intriguing. And the rumors that came out in the weeks afterwards was that Atta had made a deal with the Taliban to facilitate these attacks. And essentially what Atta was doing was he was giving the Taliban permission to conduct attacks in certain districts, in districts particularly where Atta wasn't very strong. What does the UN do when there's been a series of attacks? They shut down polling stations. So these all happen right before the election, and Atta has it happen only in areas where he's not strong. So in all the areas that weren't going to vote for Atta, now the polling stations are shut down. Now they hold an election only in the districts that support Atta, and Atta's candidates run the table. So there's this really interesting connection in Afghanistan in these last years between violence and elections. All of a sudden, this competition for resources opens up the politics to a violence that you wouldn't see in other cases. And this really sort of plays out time and time again. One more. And so this, just to give you a sense, these are just some pictures from voting day. You can see these are all women. There's women's polling stations and men's polling stations. And this is an event that really people get into. In particular, in a place like Istalif, a lot of the old men would hang around outside the polling station to see who voted, who hadn't voted. Very gossipy. And just to show you the competition for resources, this is a provincial council ballot for the district of Kabul. You can sort of make out here, everybody's got their name, a picture, and then a little symbol in case people are illiterate. But this ballot in Kabul is for the provincial council, which had 530 something candidates in it. This is actually only 2 pages of a 12-page ballot that when you fold it, it's like one of those sort of glossy fashion magazines that's difficult to slide into the ballot box. 530, and then again, it, as in the American system, you get one vote. And some of the, if you think about it, really one of the keys then becomes locating your candidate on here, right? So some of the really successful candidates were the ones who sort of composed these snappy jingles, like, vote for me, page 4, column 2, number 5. And then you can sort of vote, find out your guy there. But this just sort of shows you, first of all, that all of these guys saw getting elected to the provincial council, or at least participating in this, as a valuable political act. But you can see it sort of picking up all of a sudden these the tensions, it ratchets up the tensions. One of the great, and of course with 530 candidates, most people lose, right? And most people know they're gonna lose, and yet they're still participating. Picking apart and asking people why, you get some really intriguing stories. I spoke with one man, and I asked him, he had been very direct with me, so I became increasingly direct with him, and I said, well, why are you running? You're probably gonna lose. And he says, oh, I know I'm gonna lose. But one of my cousins, and it wasn't really his cousin, it was more like a third or fourth cousin. Well, my cousin is running. My cousin and I have a long-standing feud, and we've got some land that we have a dispute over. And right now, nobody's using the land. But if my cousin wins, he's all of a sudden going to be a member of the provincial council and will be stronger than me, and he'll be able to take that land. But if I run, half of my village will vote for me, half of my village will vote for my cousin, and we'll both lose. So it's in his best interest to run, make sure people don't vote for his cousin, and then at least that land stays at nobody's. So you can see how these other political issues all of a sudden start playing out in this massive, sloppy, very confusing ballot. Go ahead. And for particularly younger people, this creates a situation where there's an increasing resentment about the political system, about elections, about the idea of democracy. And this is interesting because Afghans, especially young Afghans, love the idea of elections. They're very pro-democracy. Everybody talks about the idea and the theory of elections. But then they say how elections have played out in Afghanistan have been bad for Afghanistan. They've made things worse. But the idea are great. And why have they made things work? Well, particularly what happened was the international community, in its rush to get out of Afghanistan, one of our markers is holding elections. And we hold elections as fast as we can so that we can say, listen, they elected their own government, hands off, we can leave them alone. Especially with a high voter turnout, right? This becomes sort of a marker of success in the international community. But now one of the problems with that is when you hold an election in an unstable political environment, who wins that election? In an unstable political environment, people who win are the people who are strongest. It's not the people with the best ideas. It's not the people who are best educated. It's the people who have access to guns, access to influence, access to money. So here's a good example. This is the local commander of the town I lived in, who in 2010 had decided, so in 2002, he laid down his weapons. And the government, in exchange for laying down his weapons, the Karzai government gave him a Toyota dealership because that's sort of the deals that were made. So he sort of laid down his weapons, but you can tell he's not a Toyota dealership kind of guy. So he made his son run the Toyota dealership while he sort of stayed at home. These are little pepper trees. He's very into his pepper trees. But in 2010, he decides that he's going to run for parliament. So here, all of a sudden, are his election posters. And I put the two up here. These are both for him. You can see they've got the same symbol there, the three pairs. But here, clearly, the young man, right? Anything else strike you about that picture? What's he wearing?
Is it a flak jacket?
It's not a flak jacket. It's sort of it's more felt, but it's along the right line. This is the kind of sort of warm clothing that you wear when you're up in the mountains firing rockets down on the Soviets, right? And this is also him as a younger, vigorous man. So he's campaigning on the fact that he did jihad against the Soviets, even though he now actually looks like this. So he sort of distributed the two posters around, one to sort of tell you he's a wise man with status in the community, but the other one sort of reminding you that he was once this fierce warrior who sort of camped out in the mountains for days on end. And this is sort of a thick wool jacket right there, but not at all what he would wear in his day-to-day life right there. So these elections then became sort of this opening for figures like this commander to reinsert themselves into politics. And he's not the only one. So this is happening on a bunch of different levels. I talked a little bit. This is Atta Muhammad Noor, governor from the north, who I discussed before. And so he's sort of up here in the political hierarchy. The warlord on the previous slide, that's just Istalif. He's sort of a low-level guy. This guy right here is quite interesting. His name is Pachahan Zadran. He's one of the key members of the Zadran tribe, which are along the border with Pakistan. And if you've probably heard something about the Haqqani network. The Haqqani network is sort of a terrorist, criminal, tribal network, spider web of people that's loosely affiliated with Al-Qaeda, but not part of Al-Qaeda. They don't have the same ideology as Al-Qaeda, but they are sort of interested in instability and more in profiteering than anything else. The Haqqani network is made up almost entirely of Zadrans, which is a tribe, not purely of Zadrans, but they make up the central part of the Haqqani network. Pachahan Zadran is the most powerful Zadran not in the Haqqani network. So the Karzai government and the U.S. government, frankly, has worked very hard to keep him on Karzai's side. Because if he stays on the Karzai side, not all the Zadrans are in the Haqqani network, and the Haqqani network is a little bit weaker. So that's sort of his background. Pachahan Zadran runs for parliament in both 2010 and in 2005. And he's an interesting figure because he is a warlord in the worst sense of the term. He's committed crimes against other neighboring groups. More recently, as I've gone to conduct interviews in sort of his home turf, there's a story going around his fortress, for lack of a better word, is up on a hill. And there's a driveway that approaches it that sort of snakes around. And he apparently didn't like the fact that the driveway wasn't straight. So he bulldozed straight through the center of a village so that his driveway would sort of look a little more regal and coming straight up to his house. He was appointed governor of another neighboring area. And the locals wouldn't let him into the area. So he started firing rockets at his capital, essentially. But the intriguing thing that happens is when you interview people in Zadran's neighborhood, when you interview his people in these villages, they will talk for an hour about what an awful guy he is and the terrible things that he's done. And then, towards the end of the interview, I'll ask, well, who are you going to vote for? Well, we're going to vote for Pachahan Zadran, they say. And at first, my sort of knee-jerk reaction to this, in my sort of American reaction to this is like, these stupid tribes, right? What's going on here? This doesn't make any sense. But as you start to pick things apart, there's a more interesting explanation than that. This is not just stupid knee-jerk tribalism. What it is this fear of what's going to happen after 2014. Because after 2014, the Americans are leaving. Who knows if the Karzai government's going to stay up. And the Taliban are going to come back in places. And when that happens, we're going to see sort of this massive instability. We're going to see the Taliban coming back in. And sort of the apple cart's going to get upset. So if we're in a community with this warlord, who is a bad warlord that we don't like, at least he's our warlord. And this guy might be looking out for our interests when the Taliban come. If we choose the really smart technocrat who's really good at filling out government documents, is he going to help us out when the Taliban come? No. So better to keep Pacha Hanzadran on our side than to let him go someplace else. And so oftentimes you get votes like that. And so what I want to leave you with is for this 2014 transition, 2014, most American troops gone, a new president after Karzai, I want to give two concerns and two reasons for hope. And the 2000, and your concerns, first of all, are that while there's negotiations going on between Karzai and the Taliban and the US, the negotiations don't include these guys, these sort of mid-level figures. So even if Karzai and the US and the Taliban, for some miracle, make peace tomorrow, these guys aren't necessarily on board with that. And what's going to happen to these mid-level commanders, these mid-level government officials, and these merchants who have made quite a bit of money off of the current stability? Are they going to stay on board when all of this happens? That's a real concern. The second one, which is tied to this, is the political economy of the withdrawal. Right now, this is a base not too far north of Istalif, but the international community, both in terms of development funds, but also more importantly, in terms of sort of economic connections to these bases. These bases hire tons of people who live in the local community and then work there. These bases are built with materials that's been imported from Pakistan. And a lot of the materials fall off the truck on the way in. So the bazaars around these bases are sort of teeming with things which some of them are there for legitimate reasons. Some of them have probably been stolen. And in particular, figures that have connections with the military on this base all of a sudden become these really important figures who can get you a job, who can get you materials to build your house. There's an entire economy that's sprung up all across the country where these different commanders have established relationships with the US military, which has made them money, which they have then sort of turned around and spread back into the community. So what's going to happen to these guys and to this economic system as they the US troops pull out? One of my favorite figures who I'm actually using for a book that I'm working on is a young man who was a taxi driver, spoke a little bit of English, and he had a distant relation who was an important warlord, but he himself was from a fairly weak family. And essentially what happened was he used a connection on the base to get a contract for barbed wire. This is in 2002. Small contract for a couple tens of thousands of dollars. He used this connection, parlayed it into another contract, and then another contract. And at one point, when he bid for a really big contract, he called up his uncle, who was the warlord, had the warlord threaten anyone else who submitted a bid. So he was able to jack up the prices on that so high that he started sort of establishing this entire import-export construction business until he finally got the fuel contract for a large number of these bases. And with these fuel contracts, right, you're paying sort of per truck that comes in because it's with the U.S. government. The U.S. government forces you to get insurance. So he developed all these sort of scams where one in every five trucks he would stop, empty the fuel out, sell the fuel to the local community, and then blow the truck up and say that the Taliban had done it. Because the U.S. required him to get insurance, he could then collect on the insurance. He could sell the fuel. But he could also, the next time the fuel contract came up, and it came up every year, he could jack up the prices even more because he was saying, look at how dangerous this is, I'm losing trucks, blah, 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 blah. So this guy is fascinating because he's made a killing off of the international community. And right now when I sat down to talk to him about this stuff, and I know there's some good news, bad news here. I tend to look at the rosy side of things. But he's talking about setting up a construction business. He's talking about building some factories and sort of moving from this lucrative skimming off the top of the military into more legitimate enterprises. That's one option. The other option, of course, is he could move from these lucrative contracts and move into probably drug smuggling or gun running. And this is, he could go either way right now. He's sort of on the fence with this stuff. And he's one of literally hundreds of these figures across the country who have sort of established a position in this political economy, but we're about to see a massive economic shift as all of this money leaves the country. So which way is he going to go? That's the real question there. And which way are all of these figures going to go as we sort of see these bases shut down and increasingly you see UN trucks that look like that, right? And so quite interestingly, the price on vehicles in Kabul has dropped drastically in the last 12 months, in part because all of these groups are pulling out. So all these NGOs have bought sort of fleets of vehicles, and they're now leaving them behind, and the market's now sort of flooded with cheap vehicles. So there's some really interesting opportunities here, too. A couple of my friends are building homes right now because they think that materials are really cheap and that there's going to be some instability coming up, and then materials prices are going to increase. So better to buy all that stuff now, and better to get married right now. Don't save that, because who knows what's going to happen if fighting breaks out. If you've got a chance to sort of solidify an alliance with another family, do it. Two reasons for hope. Reason number one is the one that I sort of started off with, that Afghan society has an egalitarian structure where they ideals in a lot of ways are very American. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. This idea of every man having the right to speak, the right to vote, is an important one in Afghan society. So to a certain extent, it's in the DNA there. And as I sort of demonstrated with Istilif in the beginning, Istilif, one of the reasons it was so stable is because the US and other groups hadn't gone in and messed things up, essentially. There weren't these extra resources to compete for. When there's extra resources, things fall apart. So Istilif was a community that was very much able to preserve peace without those external forces. Reason number two for hope is 50% of Afghanistan's population is 20 or younger. You have a country with a massive youth bubble coming up. And it's a youth bubble that in some interesting ways, is actually very pro-Afghanistan. These are pictures from last week's Pakistan-Afghanistan soccer match. And everybody's in the stands chanting Afghanistan, Zindabad, which means Afghanistan, may it live. But if you can't tell from these pictures very well, but the intriguing thing about this was this group was Pashtun, Hazara, Uzbek. There was every ethnicity represented, very close quarters around me. And the youth are very much tired of that commander who I just showed you on those pictures. They're tired of these older men who are stealing their economic and political opportunities. And there's a real sense that they want to turn away from that. The question is, how are they going to? And that's something that I'm doing some studying about, studies right now of youth and political parties. And there is some hope there. And there's some hope that as long as these commanders don't drift too much towards instability as these elections show up next year, that there is the possibility that some of these young political parties can come in. But 2014 is going to be an interesting year for Afghanistan. Thanks. I'm happy to take any questions.
I just saw something on the internet today, I think, about that the women weren't going to be able to vote in 2014 because they're saying they're threatening violence. What is that? Can you speak to that?
Legally, they'll be able to vote.
Right.
And in fact, you can go forward one more. Legally, they'll be able to vote. And in fact, Afghanistan has, as many European countries, has female guarantees in terms of number of women in parliament and on the provincial councils. So there's, by percentage, more women in Afghanistan's parliament than there is in either our House of Representatives or our Senate. So there's certain, in some ways, the Constitution is written to be actually more progressive in terms of its defending of women's rights in theory. That's not how it plays out at home, right? And so the real thing that women are suffering from is, first of all, if the men in your family don't let you vote, which is the first problem. The bigger problem, and that doesn't happen in, it happens more in the South than it does in the center and north of the country. But as I said, votes count and really matter, so men still want their women to vote, normally. The South of the country, less so. And there is also increasingly Taliban threatening other families who are allowing their women to vote. So that's what's growing. Legally, they'll be allowed to vote. It's just whether the family will be concerned about Taliban retribution. The other intriguing thing, and this is not as optimistic, but the other intriguing thing is, I think it was Wardak. I can't remember the province. But there's a couple provinces that reported in the voter turnout numbers that 70% of all voters were women. This, of course, the reason this happens is because in the south of the country, you can't do this in the area that I lived in, but in the south of the country, if you're a Pashtun man, you can go to the polling station with your voting card, and then you can show up with your voting card and with 12 other voting cards and say, these are the voting cards of my women, whether it's your wife or your daughters or whatever. And then vote 13 times, essentially. So that increases female turnout, even though it doesn't.
Do the women who win elections, do they exercise power?
There are some very feisty, very intelligent female members of parliament. Not all of them, but Shokri Barakzai is one of the made ones. Kufi, I can't remember her first name. So there are a series of female parliamentarians who are very well connected also with international embassies and with women's rights organizations, and they have made a lot of noise in parliament. That being said, there's other ones which are not as strong, and there's some cases of essentially men having their wives run in their positions and then sort of vote as they tell them to. But again, it's certainly not all a bleak picture, and there are some real sort of pioneers for women's rights. The question, again, particularly in 2014, is the women have a certain amount of momentum right now, and does that get cut off as negotiations with the Taliban come in, or are they allowed to keep moving in this direction? Certainly women's rights in the center and north of the country are probably going to be in okay shape. In the south of the country is the place that we should be really concerned. But one of the interesting things I found just this last trip, I'm doing a lot of work again on these young political movements, and women are members of those movements, certainly. Not equal 50-50, but they're members. And there's also a real push, particularly with concerns about what happens next, to get education now. So a lot of women in universities trying to move into higher education now because they know they can, and there's no guarantee that they will be able to 3 years from now.
I wrote a book a couple of years ago called Woman Among Warlords.
Yes.
And now, granted, it was a couple of years ago, but she was actually ousted from the parliament for speaking out against the warlords and
yes.
Karzai. Do you has the situation improved since her particular experience?
The problem, and this is a lot of what I was discussing with that commander in the poster there, is that Karzai has made deals with a series of former commanders who are now political leaders. A great example, the vice president, is a guy named Marshall Fahim, who's an absolute thug. Dogfighting industry in the south of the country essentially shut down because he liked dogfighting so much that he had bought or stolen all the dogs. This is sort of the type of guy he is. It's sort of like what the Yankees do in baseball, right? You can buy everybody. Sorry, those are my tribal loyalties. And so the problem is when these figures have a lot of formal and informal pull, so when one of these figures says, either directly or indirectly, and this is what happened in Women Among Warlords, essentially, that we're going to kill you if you don't leave. She wasn't expelled from Parliament for any legal reasons. She was essentially threatened. And the state is not currently strong enough to protect somebody from assassination attempts like that. So that's a very difficult situation. The women who have been more successful thus far have sort of balanced how they speak to some of these elders with, and tried to sort of maintain connections with one or two of them with this sort of Western liberalism. And if you go too far this way, quite often you're sort of banished from the political scene. So that's a different, difficult situation.
How serious, how large, maybe is the better word than serious, is the Taliban resurgence threat?
Well, the problem is, if anybody tells you they know how big the Taliban are, they're lying. Everybody has an idea. But the really difficult thing to measure is how many people are Taliban because they believe in the Taliban ideology of hard radical Islam, and how many are sons of farmers who can't raise that $10,000 to get married, who are disgruntled with a corrupt state that hasn't delivered on their promises, who are disgruntled with an American invading army who said in 2001 we're going to bring peace and prosperity to Afghanistan, and right now they're driving big troop carriers through my wheat field. So how many are on each of those levels is very difficult to tell. My opinion, and I think most people's opinion, is that those disgruntled young farmers who have joined the Taliban because the Taliban will pay them, and because they're tired of seeing international troops driving through their backyard, make up the vast majority of the Taliban foot soldiers. So with all of a sudden U.S. troops out, a lot of those guys are just going to go home. That doesn't mean the Taliban's going to disappear, but that it's going to shrink back to sort of its more ideological core. So I'm personally of the opinion that the Taliban's not going to have much reach outside of the South, which is really its heartland. But during the insurgency, in part because there were so many troops spread out across the country, you saw these flare-ups all across the country. A lot more of that are sort of disgruntled youth who don't have any other outlet. But it will be really interesting to see how that plays out and whether the Taliban try to continue to expand their control. But this is the other thing in terms of, I think, particularly U.S. policy on this stuff, is the U.S. has made a mess of fixing Kandahar. Kandahar is one of the largest cities. There's no stability down there. It's generally prosperous. There's good fields around it for agriculture. And tons of money has been sort of sunk in there. There's no safety. The roads aren't paved. There's corruption, crime in the bazaar. The U.S. sort of installed governor has essentially failed. But the thinking is, and so the Taliban is able to say, look it, you guys are not building roads, you guys have not set up schools, you haven't done this, you haven't done this, you haven't done this. And the thinking on one level is, okay, give it to the Taliban. Then all of a sudden, they're the ones who have to build the roads, set up schools, all this other stuff. They've been put in a position of strength, in part because they're just allowing, they've been allowed to argue against a failed argument for so long. So it'll be interesting to see, because all of a sudden they don't have to actually do anything to gain political legitimacy. They have legitimacy by not being in power right now.
I'm kind of worried about that age structure. You put a kind of positive spin on their political potential, but in a society that's going to be experiencing a lot of economic dislocations, I wonder how they're going to absorb that enormous number of young people that are entering the workforce who are in other Middle Eastern countries a real challenge.
Mm.
Do you see that going better in Afghanistan?
I see it going better, and I mean, this is one of those interesting things, and actually I meant to mention this. I see what you're saying in Afghanistan. I think I have a different interpretation of some of the Arab Spring in the rest of the Middle East, where the Arab Spring, in particular in Egypt, for example, is a great example of rushed elections, right? The youth in Tahrir Square, who were much more pro-democracy and anti-authoritarian government, were the ones who brought down the government. They then quickly held elections. The youth in Tahrir Square lost the elections. Why? Because they were disorganized. They were a bunch of kids with new ideas. Who won? Well, the Islamic Brotherhood did, because the Muslim Brotherhood did. Why? Because they had an organized structure that was sort of prepared to swoop in. So they're the ones who ended up getting power, even though it was the youth that brought it down. In Afghanistan, I think you're right to think about some of the economic challenges that's presented. But the real problem that you get in Afghanistan is when we start talking about the Karzais, when we talk about Rabbani, when we talk about Sayyaf, when we talk about Hekmatyar, these are all the key political players in Afghanistan. They were also the key political players in Afghanistan in 1978 when this all started. So you've essentially got exactly the same guys at the top who fought against the Soviets, who fought in the Civil War, who fought or fled with the Taliban. There's got to be a change at some point. And the current system just isn't working.
What are your thoughts about Al-Qaeda coming back again in the future?
I don't think you're going to see much of them. I don't know a ton about this type of thing, but my understanding of it is they've gotten increasingly comfortable in Yemen and in places like Mali. And in particular, what I think you're not going to get is the Taliban made a real mistake when they harbored Osama bin Laden, and they now realize that. And the Taliban's ideology is not that far removed from Al-Qaeda, but it is removed from Al-Qaeda. They don't see eye to eye on a lot of the ideological stuff, and they realize that they got kicked out of power in part because they supported Al-Qaeda. So I would, and particularly as we move forward, if the Taliban want to come into a settlement process and they realize giving up on Al-Qaeda is going to gain them a lot in the eyes of the West and in the eyes of the Karzai government, that I'd be very surprised if you see much of a move back by Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan. That's not to say that there won't be a presence there, but I think you're going to see it springing up in other places, and I think Al-Qaeda's planning for that as well, which I think is one of the big pushes where they shut down all those embassies in the Middle East, but particularly evacuated the Americans from Yemen.
You, as an American, how did you get along with folks, and what did they ask you about America, and what's America going to do for us?
Well, one of the things I like to say, and this is really true, I first went to Afghanistan to begin my preliminary research in 2005, and I really just got lucky. Things were pretty secure in 2005. By the time I was there full-time in 2006, I was sort of in this village. The community had taken me in. Afghans are incredibly hospitable, and once I was that guest, I was there. And so in some ways, in terms of security, the town did my security for me. And it was kind of funny because, again, I said they're Tajik. And so I would have little boys sort of run up to my house and bang in the door. And they'd say, there's two Pashtun guys in the bazaar. You shouldn't go down there. Which, of course, just sort of was ridiculously exaggerated. But so everybody was sort of looking out for me. The other thing that's interesting and I find terribly endearing is Afghanistan, the Afghans have this lovely inflated sense of self-worth. And Afghanistan is, in their eyes, the greatest country in the world. And if it wasn't for the British, and then the Soviets, and then the Americans, and the Taliban tossed in there, we would be leading the world right now. And it's really these foreigners who come in and keep ruining stuff. Right? So as an anthropologist, this is the intriguing thing. I'm at BU talking to all my colleagues who, I had a good friend who was doing women's involvement in politics in Syria. And she came back just so frustrated, in part because you'd sit down with a woman and say, well, how do you feel about politics? And she'd say, what do I know? I'm just a woman. Don't talk to me. Talk to somebody else. In Afghanistan, if you say, as I did in Istanbul, explain what you're doing, I would say in general, and what they decided quite early on, they sort of pushed all the anthropology stuff aside and decided I was writing a book. And I was writing a book about Istalith, and of course I was writing a book about Istalith. Who wouldn't want to write a book about Istalith? In fact, who wouldn't want to write a book about me? Let me sit you down and tell you my story. So you sort of had almost this line of people who were just really pleasant and very eager to talk to me, which makes your research much easier on one level. And just to sort of reinforce that, Potters early on, this was before I was there, so it must have been around 2004, a Japanese fine arts NGO had come and taken some of the potters to Japan to study Japanese pottery. And they came back with just this sort of utter disdain for these Japanese potters who didn't know what they were doing, and if only we had these nice kilns and these nice wheels, we would be able to do that ourselves. And did you know that the Japanese don't eat bread? What is wrong with them? And so the thing that was just terrific is they had this guy, I think he must have been, he was their sort of chauffeur slash facilitator who I think must have worked at the Afghan embassy or something, and there was a Indian restaurant 45 minutes from where they were staying. They would essentially send this guy 45 minutes each direction to buy them dinner every night because they just refused to eat any of the Japanese food. So it's great, it's pieces like that.
Is there any significance, the pottery is blue,
mm-hmm.
and I noticed all the women going into boat, blue robe.
Interesting.
The mosques, yeah, the mosques somewhere. Are blue.
Yep. So the in terms of the pottery, it's not, just because that's the classic glaze that they make there, which they
given the material
dig up. Yeah, they dig it up. It's this root, which they then burn. They grind up the ash, and that's the reason that they make the blue like that.
What's the significance of blue robes?
But the burkas are different.
Yeah, the burkas vary. So, I mean, up north you'll see them in white more often. Around Istalith they were primarily blue.
It's a favored color in architecture.
Absolutely,
and
yeah,
and
sort of tile making.
So it's timeless.
Blue mosque, exactly.
Yeah. This is off the subject, but you know the answer. When the men in the village talk about who's going to run in
mm-hmm.
Karzai's place, who are they talking about?
In part, and this is one of the problems and the frustrations of the youth right now, is they're not talking about anybody. Because they think Karzai and a couple of these top-level figures like Atta, and, very importantly, the U.S. ambassador and the British ambassador and a couple of these other people are having high-level secret meetings. And that eventually they're going to have this high-level meeting where they decide who's going to win, and then we're going to have this election, but it's going to be a sham, and it's already going to be decided. So in terms of the election itself, they're interested in who that's going to be, but the debate is over how it's going to be rigged. In terms of the elections themselves, in my personal interest, the thing they are talking about is who's going to run for parliament. Because different parliamentarians can win, and if you have a parliamentarian from your neighborhood or from your town, that can really affect the balance of power. So they are talking about elections. They're not talking about the presidential elections as much, other than in a gossipy way. And this is actually a really interesting point, too, and again, where us internationals, and by us internationals, I also mean sort of UN election monitors and things like that, really miss the big picture, is in 2009, you had presidential elections and provincial council elections. And everybody agrees that Karzai won after committing a massive amount of fraud. But Karzai committed a massive amount of fraud. The other guy committed a massive amount of fraud. And Karzai didn't commit enough fraud that he would have lost. So there was a bunch of noise in the media, in the embassies, about all this fraud and how we had to address all this fraud. And the thing that Afghans were baffled by was, well, if we do this all over again, Karzai's still going to win. It's not enough to actually change. He'd won by millions and millions of votes. In the meantime, though, in the provincial council, there was fraud all over the place, and people were winning and losing by less than 100 votes. And your provincial candidate then had a real shape on your daily life, and nobody in the international community cared at all about fraud in the provincial elections. And it was just, even at the embassies, it was not a conversation that was going on. We were sort of concerned about the big show, whereas on a day-to-day basis, nobody cared about the Karzai fraud. Everybody cared about the provincial council fraud, and there were sort of these local stories of ballot boxes being stuffed. And in an election that's tight, one stuffed ballot box can make the entire difference between being in and being out.
What is the relationship between Afghanistan and most of its neighbors, so specifically Pakistan and Iran?
Very tense.
Very
tense, yeah. With Pakistan, long-standing animosity, but also deep cultural connections. Lots of Afghans will tell you Peshawar, which is one of the major cities just over the border, should be in Afghanistan still. But in the meantime, you've got these nomad groups that go back and forth. Lots of people have relatives across the border. So there's sort of this deep connection, but also this deep tension with it. And both with Pakistan and with Iran, there's a sense that they're both meddling in Afghanistan to keep Afghanistan weak. And so lots of sort of rumors about how that's going on. One of the really interesting things in terms of regional politics that I've heard a lot about is Iranian businessmen. I talked to you about how all the cars are sort of flooding the markets. Iranian businessmen moving into Kabul and buying property. And so there's a sense that particularly Iran is making sort of a development push into Afghanistan by buying low as all the internationals are pulling out and are going to sort of really then have large numbers of business connections with sort of similar parallels with China and the mining industry potentially happening as well.
So do you speak Dari or Pashto?
Dari, well, Pashtun. But in my town was Dari speaking. And the interesting thing is Pashtun's, Dari's an easy language. It's Indo-European, it has one irregular verb, no masculine, feminine, no cases. Pashtun's a very difficult language. So the interesting thing is most Dari speakers in Afghanistan don't speak Pashto, but a lot of Pashto speakers do speak Dari, or at least well enough to sort of chat in the bazaar. So it's sort of split, but the Dari is a little more useful. Particularly.
Is there one national language the way there is in India, or is it all?
No,
so
it's accepted.
The various tribes,
both of them,
speak different languages and can't communicate.
Yes,
with each other.
And it then makes confusing things like it. So Dari and Pashto are both official languages of Afghanistan. So you, as a parliamentarian, can get up in parliament and give a speech in either.
What's taught in the schools?
It depends what part of the country you're in. So it's confusing, but like I said, most Pashto speakers will understand the Dari. The real problem is the Dari speakers who don't understand the Pashto.
So, and did I hear that after fifth grade now they're required to learn English as well?
I doubt that they're required to. They do have English lessons in a large number of the schools, and the kids really want to learn English. It's seen as very much a gateway to economic opportunity. But I don't know if it's required.
How about the schools in that town? Were there high schools for
boys
and girls?
Yeah, and I'm not going to give you the numbers because I don't know them exactly, but I can't remember the millions of increase that they have in terms of women in particular attending school. And it is one of the sort of great successes of us over there, which sort of gets undersold. That and public health. Life expectancy is essentially 10 years longer now than it was when the Taliban were there, in part because, while the internationals have screwed up a lot of stuff, one of the things they have been successful is with particularly the Ministry of Public Health, but setting up a clinic network all across the country with these sort of trained, they're sort of nurse practitioner types instead of doctors who go around, which is actually really intriguing. I don't speak to women very much, but I've got a sort of partner in crime who I do some research with who talks to the women, and she says that the women are much more pro-Western than the men oftentimes because the women are going to these clinics that they sort of know were built by the West. And so my town had had one boys' high school and one girls' high school. The girls' high school was built by the French, the boys' high school was built by the Germans, and then had a large clinic that was built by the Canadians. And that was very much appreciated, I guess. But then they can't understand, we did all this great stuff, why can't you just stop screwing up all the other stuff? So it's interesting how it then sort of leads to other frustrations in interesting ways.
So do you think all the international groups are going to leave, or is it just going to be the Americans?
I don't think they'll all leave, and we're going to leave military advisors or something like that, right? I don't know yet what that means, and I don't think we've even figured out exactly what that means. So there will still be some U.S. troops there, and several other countries will continue that. In terms of development funding, a lot of groups like the World Bank and the UN are saying that they're going to continue on as they have been and not draw down. The real question is whether they're going to have the capability to do that in areas that become unstable. So even one of the big problems right now for US and international development companies is they have these huge budgets, but sometimes they haven't even been able to spend it just because they can't carry out the projects that they have been doing. So as things become more unstable, it's possible that the money might still be there, but they can't quite implement those projects. The other thing that I'd be concerned about is in a town like Istilif had a few of these big money projects, but then they had a bunch of little NGOs that were actually doing some really good, interesting, creative stuff. If you're a little NGO and things get more unstable, then you have to pay for security, you have to pay for, it gets much more difficult to keep your staff there, whereas someone like the UN has this whole infrastructure to take care of that type of thing. So I think the big NGOs are probably going to continue more or less on the way they have been. I'm concerned about the smaller NGOs probably pulling out.
But a lot of other countries do this kind of work all the time. Mm. With their own funds.
Yes.
Will they continue, do you think?
I think some of them will and some of them won't. I think the ones most connected to the counterinsurgency, like Britain, Australia, the US, you'll see massive drawdowns in terms of troops and funding spent. I think ones that were never involved in, or were less involved in counterinsurgency and saw this more as a state-building exercise, thinking about the Scandinavian countries, I'm thinking about Germany. To a lesser extent, I think you're going to see more of a maintenance there. But most of those countries, they also didn't spike up how much they introduced, and they climbed some through 6, 7, 8, 9, but not massively. So I think you're going to see similar commitments from those Scandinavian countries. And then you've got actually some really interesting sort of new NATO members, like the Bulgarians and the Romanians, who really want to be seen as loyal to the US and to NATO because they are new members. So I think you're going to see with them a sort of longer, stronger commitment to the cause. And then another slight variation of that is I think you're going to see a longer-term commitment from some Muslim countries like Turkey. So I heard that a couple key posts at ISAF, which is basically NATO command, just swung over to the Turks. And that's actually quite interesting. The commander of ISAF for the last four iterations now has been American. You had McChrystal and Petraeus, of course. But before that was British. And I think what you're going to see probably the next one, I wouldn't be surprised if they're not American, partially to sort of give it more of an international feel, because it drifted from being sort of a NATO mission to being a U.S. mission. And now the U.S. is really trying to push it back to being a NATO mission.
Is the building pictured here a small mosque?
The building here is a small shrine. This is in Babur's garden, which is this sort of one lovely little stretch of outside of Kabul that has been rebuilt. And I don't think his mother's grave's in it. His mother's grave's up on the hill a little bit more here, but it's this sort of lovely little spot that the emperor, who I mentioned, built there.
Was he an Afghan?
He was of Uzbek descent. The Baburnama is his autobiography, which is an intriguing read. His father was an Uzbek leader in the Fergana Valley, and he basically became this sort of wandering king. And so he conquered Kabul, and then conquered Herat, and then lost Kabul, and then reconquered Kabul, and then eventually conquered India a couple times. And that's where he really set up in Delhi. But then when he was in Delhi, lost Kabul, and then sort of wrote these poems about how he had left his soul in Kabul. And so he eventually had his son bring his body back to Kabul. So he was king, but sort of a moving empire. And his autobiography, he talks about how we raided this village and we cut off the heads of 150 people. And then I went out and counted the number of tulips that were out in the fields around. So he has this sort of lyrical poet in him combined with this sort of brutality, which is really alarming. Yes?
Was the reconstruction another Aga Khan project?
Yes, this reconstruction is an Aga Khan project. And the Aga Khan sponsors a lot of this type of projects around there.
The houses pictured here, do they have plumbing and electricity? And
those appear to me to be illegal settlements, which are sort of spreading up the hillsides all along Kabul. And so most of these will not have running water, and you sort of have to haul the water up yourself. But some of these, you will find Afghans you sort of want your car to break down in Afghanistan, right? Because there's no spare parts. So everybody knows how to fix everything. And it's a similar thing with electricity and things like that. So none of these houses legally have electricity, but many of my friends who live in such places have electricity because they've sort of strung this very dangerous wire up. And I was in an area for a while behind the Ministry of Finance, and essentially this entire neighborhood, they had basically climbed onto the roof of the Ministry of Finance, like shoved a plug in the socket, and then had literally powered like hundreds and hundreds of houses. And then it would blow out, and then of course the Ministry of Finance knew, but they were paying somebody. So they probably have electricity, no running water.
Well, this is very interesting.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.